everybody. It's great to meet with you this evening. We hope you've had a lovely weekend and a very good week as well. And a warm welcome to Junction One this evening. I'm Cordelia and this is Mark. Tonight, we are continuing with our interviews for leaders who have recently planted churches. And our guest this evening is actually a friend of ours, Richard Leadbeater, from King's Church in Guildford, and he is part of the AMI network of churches. And later on, he's also going to be sharing from God's Word from 1 Timothy.
At the end of tonight, we'll meet for 10 minutes, as we always do, on Zoom for discussion and for prayer. If you don't have a login, then please send us a message through our website, junctionone.org, and then we'll try to get a passwords and joining details to you by the end. Now, of course, we've had VE Day commemorations this weekend across the country. Perhaps you've seen coverage on TV or had some events in the street with neighbours. I was reading the Order of Service from Westminster Abbey from VE Day 1945, and I was struck by a prayer which came towards the end of that service, which they'd taken from the inauguration speech given by Abraham Lincoln the second time he was president in 1865. And I wanted to share it with you. I thought it's really applicable for our time with this COVID-19 that we have. Grant, O merciful God, that with malice toward none, with charity to all, with firmness in the right as thou givest us to see the right, we may strive to finish the task which thou hast appointed us, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
So I'm going to pray for some similar points, and then we will move into our first song. Father God, as we come together tonight in this time of national struggle, please help us to have charity towards all by helping our friends and neighbours in need. Help us to bind up the nation's wounds by thanking and encouraging those who work so hard in the NHS and as other key workers. And please help us to care for those who are grieving and help them to know the peace you promise of eternal life through faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to pray together now. Psalm 118 says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever."
Dear Lord, thank you for our world. Thank you for VE Day and for giving peace in our country. We pray for the people who live in wars like Syria. We ask you to protect the children who live there and help those who are working for peace. Thank you for keeping us safe during lockdown and for helping Phil to get better. Thank you for helping the key workers to fight the virus. Please be with the people who have the virus and have to stay in all the time for treatment. Please help those who are grieving for people that have lived lost to the virus. Thank you for our church online. Please be with all the people who are watching in Bromsgrove or anywhere else. Please help us to be kind and loving towards you and towards each other so more people can come to know you. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Because you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. Oh, you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Oh, it's love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me.
Okay, so we move to the part of our gathering now where we are speaking with somebody who's recently planted a church. And this week we're talking to Richard Leadbeater, or Leddy, as everybody calls him. So, Leddy, thank you very much for joining us this evening. And for the benefit of everybody else, could you just explain what was the church that you planted, and where in the country are you?
So we're called King's Church in Guildford, so in Surrey. London is a clock face. We're sort of 7 o'clock just outside London. We've been going for 6 years now. We're six in September.
Fantastic, thank you. And before you planted in Guildford, you were at St Stephen's, weren't you? Which is how we know you.
Yeah, so assistant minister, sort of ordained in the Church of England, and an assistant minister for 4 years. Before that, I was on the staff at St Stephen's as a sort of apprentice and youth worker. Yeah.
And could you explain to us what part your church plays in the AME organisation and why you've chosen to be part of that.
Yeah, so AME is the acronym for the Anglican Mission in England. And I'm both a member of that by the fact that I lead a church that is part of that network. I'm also a board member or a trustee of the Anglican Mission in England as well. So I sort of speak with two hats on, if you like. AME describes itself as, or we describe ourselves as a fellowship of faithful Anglican churches committed to gospel mission. So it's really a network or a group of churches or a fellowship of Anglican churches all around England. I think we were the second church in 2014. There are now, I think, 16. And the prayerful plan is that there'd be 25 by 2025 and 250 by 2050. I think those plans probably aren't ambitious enough, given that we're already 16. But it's a growing network. And the reason we're part of it is because, I think for several reasons. One is it's Anglican in the best sense of that word. So we're connected theologically. We're connected globally, and we're connected historically. And in my mind, Anglican really means evangelical, given that the reformers who started the whole thing off were Bible-believing, Jesus-loving church gospel men and women. And that's what we are. So we're Anglican in the best sense of the word, and we wanted to be part of that. We didn't want to be independent, but interdependent and connected. So we have that. And the other big thing is, it's not just Anglican, but it's all about mission. It's the Anglican Mission in England. And as a new church, we wanted not just to be connected to others, but to be connected to people who are really passionate about mission, planting churches, telling people about Jesus. So we're very, very happily part of AME.
Great. Thank you very much. So when you decided to set up as a church, just quickly give us an overview of how you did that. Could you just talk us through the process from meeting together as a small group to being a sort of a live working church as you are now?
Yeah, I don't describe Kings as a church plant. I mean, every church is different and starts different. Kings started really with a small group of families, so three families living in Guildford, praying about starting a new Bible teaching Anglican church in the town. We got to hear of that little group whilst we were in Birmingham, and we joined that group for prayer for probably 8 to 10 months. So what started was a group of families living in Guildford, going to churches in Guildford, but they weren't sent out from a church. It wasn't a church plant. It was a startup from scratch kind of scenario. Before we joined to pray, there were probably a couple of families thinking and pushing doors and praying for probably 2 years before we joined. So there was a lot of prayer and pushing of doors before we even were aware of it. When we got involved, we met either physically or on things like Zoom for probably 8 to 10 months. And my wife and family and I decided to take the plunge and move down to Guildford and start from scratch. And what that looked like at the time was the three families went down to two families, because two families, I think, probably felt for different reasons, this is too risky, too small. So we were essentially four adults and seven children thinking, what on earth have we got ourselves into? But prayer was a big part of the process. I think very early on, we decided to launch publicly, although we had no idea what that looked like. This is how we did it, not how everyone should do it, by the way. This is, we thought, let's go public. Let's see what happens. So we decided to do that in September. This is in about June or July. So we had 3 months, and we were nothing. We didn't have a name. We didn't have a bank account. We didn't have a venue. We had no people. We had no money. But we did have God, and that's a good start. So very briefly, the process from there to starting publicly, aside from prayer, were thinking about logistics and legals. logistics were things like venue, finding a venue, deciding a time, getting a name, thinking about our DNA, our ministry DNA, what are we going to be about? Because we weren't planted from a church, we came from different churches. If I can use sort of business language, our USP, our unique selling points. So what are we going to focus on? Are we going to have a particular place we're going to focus on, or a particular people group we're going to focus on? Working those things out, we're all at sort of logistics. And then alongside that was, for the sake of another L, legals. So we had to register as a charity in order to get a bank account, in order to have a safeguarding policy, in order to raise money, and so on. So all those kind of things were going on at the same time as us working out, is there a school, is there a scout hut, or whatever it is. So yeah, basically prayer followed by logistics and legals, and thinking those things through and working it out.
So just finally, looking back over the process that you've been through, what would you say would be the sort of wisdom that you could pass on to us, given the situation that you're currently in?
Yeah, I can't recommend starting a church from scratch or planting a church highly enough. It's been the hardest thing I've ever done and the most joyful thing. And so I think the challenges are also the encouragements and blessings. We described it very early on as building a plane while flying a plane. Or if you've seen the Wallace and Gromit film, where there's a chase on a train, and he's laying the train track as he's being chased by the penguin or whatever it is. It's felt very much like we're laying the train track as we're hurtling towards the end of the track. But that is great because it forces you to be dependent on God, and it makes you thankful, because when you've got nothing or very little, you've got to pray, you've got to depend on God. And when you've got nothing and then you've got something, you see how God has provided that. So it's been a huge blessing to be part of. A couple of lessons we've learned. We tried from the off, and I'm still trying. When you've got a blank sheet of paper, that's both daunting and brilliant, because you think, okay, well, where shall we meet? What time shall we meet? What should we do? Why do we do that? So we tried very early on to be flexible with what the Bible's flexible on, and inflexible with what the Bible's inflexible on. And the Bible actually is flexible on a lot of things. It doesn't tell you what time on a Sunday you should meet. It doesn't tell you what kind of building you should meet in, or what you should wear, or how many songs you should have, or how long your talk should be. You know, it's flexible on a load of things. It is, of course, inflexible on things as well. So we're not flexible on the gospel. Right? The gospel is the gospel. Jesus is Lord, and we want to proclaim that. But within that, there's a lot of freedom. And so we've tried not to be flexible on the inflexibles and inflexible on the flexibles, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And I think that's helped to keep those things in mind. A couple of other things to share. I think sort of a few points that we've learned. One is, I think, be convinced that God is building his church. So what is God doing in his world? He's doing all kinds of things, but his chief thing is growing a people, establishing his kingdom that we'll one day see in heaven. But local churches are small outposts, snapshots of that great gathering. And so I'd say be convinced that God is growing churches. And so to start one and grow one, you're right in line with what God's doing in the world. So be convinced of that. Number two, related, is be committed to preaching Christ, because that's how God grows his church. It's Jesus who builds his church, not us. And so to preach him, proclaim him in sermons, Bible studies, talks, one-to-ones, conversations is absolutely key. Two more briefly, be prepared to take risks, because you've got to. It's like plunging off a cliff and not knowing where you're going to fall, but knowing that God is with you. But that involves risk taking, and that's okay. Fourth, be okay with mess, because when you leave an established church, or when you're used to an established church, there are things that you sort of take for granted that are there, like, you know, 15 kids in the youth group, or that there's a youth worker, that you've got a building. And when you haven't got those things, it's quite easy to think, oh, it was great when we had a building, or it was great when we had a youth. Be okay with mess, because God works through mess, and that's okay. Be okay with mess. And the last thing I'd say is be driven by love, by which I mean a love for God and for his glory, for one another, for Christians, and for the lost. Keep the lost in mind, because you don't start a church or plant a church, I don't think you do, or at least you shouldn't, if you haven't got any concern for reaching more people in the particular place that God has put you. So those are my sort of five quick sort of things. Be convinced that God's building his church, be committed to preaching Christ, be prepared to take risks, be okay with mess, be driven by love, and trust God. He's been building churches throughout history, so he knows what he's doing, even if we don't.
That's terrific. Thank you very much indeed. Really appreciate your time tonight. And you're also going to be sharing from God's word, aren't you, 1 Timothy?
Yes.
So thank you very much indeed for that as well.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Richard. Most people call me Leddy, and I'm pastor at King's Church, Guildford. Thanks very much for inviting me to speak. It's a real privilege to serve you in this way, and it's really exciting to hear what the Lord is doing in and through you in Bromsgrove. I thought we'd look at the start of 1 Timothy for a few minutes, but before we do that, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the Bible. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the technology to be able to speak your truth, and please be at work in our hearts now. Help us to listen. Help us to love Jesus and become more like him. Amen. I was talking to somebody a while ago about Kings, where I serve, and they asked where the church was. I told them we don't have a traditional looking building, but we meet in a school. The person looks a bit confused, even more so when I told them that we actually meet at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Meeting in a school on a Sunday afternoon was totally new to this person, totally threw them. It's not what many people think about church. The person I was talking to went on to ask if I was ever thinking of getting a real church. I think in their mind, a real church had a pointy spire, stained glass windows, and some wooden pews. What would you say real church looks like? Well, 1 Timothy shows us that a real church isn't about the building you meet in, or an institution you're part of, or even a service you go to. According to 1 Timothy, real church is about gospel proclamation, resulting in godly people reflecting God's glory. That's what a real church is. Gospel proclamation resulting in godly people reflecting God's glory. Which is why I said to the person who asked whether I'd one day get a real church, I'm already part of a real church. Well, 1 Timothy was written to a real church, but a real church in a right mess. It's clear early on in the letter that there's false teaching. There's constant friction going on. There's controversies, quarrels. There are even people wandering away from the faith and leaving the church. It's not a happy church to be part of. But as we'll see, seeing a church that's sort of far from perfect, we also get in 1 Timothy a picture that's very beautiful. Because this letter shows us God's picture of what he wants a real church to look like. And so if you want to know what Junction 1 Bromsgrove should look like, 1 Timothy is a really good place to look. Whereas we'll think briefly about what church looks like. I want us to focus on verses 3 to 11 of the first chapter and see two big things. False teaching is dangerous, and healthy teaching is essential. Let's think about verses 3 to 7 first. False teaching is dangerous. Have a look down to verse 3. Paul writes, "As I urged you when I went into Macedonia, stay there in Ephesus so that you may command certain people not to teach false doctrines any longer, or to devote themselves to myths and endless genealogies. Such things promote controversial speculations rather than advancing God's work, which is by faith." It's very sad, isn't it, when you hear of a church which used to be sound and healthy, but has now gone off the rails. Just a few years earlier, let's call it Junction 1, Ephesus,
was renowned as a brilliant Bible teaching church. The Apostle Paul was the founder, senior pastor and regular preacher. I mean, people would have come from miles around to listen to these talks and to attend this church. The sermons on the website would have had thousands of downloads every week. And now, just a few years after Paul's departure, well, the guys he'd left in charge were teaching false doctrines, literally verse 4, other things. So instead of being devoted to chapter 4, verse 13, the public reading of scripture, to preaching and teaching, they were devoted instead to chapter 1, verse 4, myths and endless genealogies. Now, there's nothing wrong with myths or made-up stories if you're reading them in a novel, but there's something seriously wrong if you're preaching them in a sermon. There's nothing wrong with genealogies. The New Testament starts with one. But there's something wrong when all you do is talk about genealogies. These teachers were not keeping the main thing, the main thing. The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ was no longer front and centre. They were majoring on minors, I guess you could say. I don't know, maybe one of these elders had done a course on genealogies at college and another had read a really interesting book about myths. And those things had become their particular hobby horses. And what was being promoted as a result? Verse 4, controversial speculations rather than advancing God's work. So they were having some lively discussions, no doubt, in their small groups. But people were leaving confused about the gospel, distracted from God's work of proclaiming the gospel to a needy world. And that's because the church grows through gospel proclamation, not through theological debates. And people grow by faith, not simply by knowledge. Which is why we need to constantly make sure we keep the main thing, the main thing. And the goal of this command, says Paul in verse 5, is love. When it comes to correcting false teaching, I must admit that my goal is often to be right, or to win the debate. But Paul says the goal is love. Love for God and love for people. Wouldn't it be great in the years ahead if Junction 1 was known not just as a sound church, a good Bible teaching church, but a loving church as well? And if you're to love, you'll need verse 5. A pure heart. That's a cleansed heart, a good conscience and a sincere faith. And those things come as a result of the gospel, not as a result of debate and speculation. See, false teaching is dangerous. It doesn't advance God's work and it doesn't produce love. Well, given the gospel had been pushed to the side, it's no surprise that some in, again, let's call it Junction 1, Ephesus, had verse 6 departed from those things in verse 5 and turned aside to meaningless talk. And you might also say ignorant talk, verse 7. They want to be teachers of the law, but they don't know what they're talking about. False teaching is dangerous. We must avoid it. Second, healthy teaching is essential. That's verses 8 to 11. In contrast to the false teachers in verse 7 who didn't know what they were talking about, Paul did know what he was talking about. Let's read from verse 8. We know, says Paul, that the law is good, if one uses it properly. We also know that the law is made not for the righteous, but for lawbreakers and rebels, the ungodly and sinful, the unholy and irreligious, for those who kill their fathers or mothers, for murderers, for the sexually immoral, for those practicing homosexuality, for slave traders and liars and perjurers, and for whatever else is contrary to sound doctrine that conforms to the gospel concerning the glory of the blessed God, which he entrusted to me. The false teachers weren't teaching the law properly, verse 7, because they were forgetting who the law was for. Laws are made for not for law keepers. Laws are made for lawbreakers. So the government doesn't pass a law telling us to breathe, because the government knows that we'll do that. We don't need help. It does pass laws telling us not to speed, because they know that we are prone to do that. You know, when I'm driving down the road and the sign lights up saying 30 miles an hour, It's showing me that I'm not going 30 miles an hour and I'm breaking the law and I need to slow down. Well, similarly, God's law in the Old Testament was given to show that we're all lawbreakers. The law that said love God with all your heart wasn't given for us to say, yep, nailed that one. It was meant to lead us to say, oh my word, I really need help with that one. I don't love God with all my heart. The light is flashing. I'm breaking the law. See, the law was never for the righteous. God's law was always for rebels, to show that we can't keep the law and that we need a saviour who does keep the law and who pays for our law breaking. That's what the law is for. And notice the law is for all kinds of people, not just a few. It's for murderers and liars, for the sexually immoral, for those who practice homosexuality. In other words, for those who have heterosexual and homosexual sex outside of marriage between one man and one woman. And just in case there's any doubt that it's for everyone, it's for whatever is contrary to the gospel. The false teachers were looking in. Healthy teaching gets you looking out. You may have heard of Amy Carmichael, who's a missionary in India in the 19th century. She tells of a dream she had once where crowds of people were walking blindfolded towards a cliff edge in the dark. And sitting with their back to all this were a group of Christians making daisy chains. Imagine that. Christians just looking inwardly, fiddling about with daisy chains, whilst people are plunging over the cliff to hell. That was Amy Carmichael's dream. That's what these false teachers are doing. The law is for this little group, looking inward. And Paul says, no. No, the law is for everyone. It gets us looking out. If you had to finish this sentence, these sentences, what would you say? Points mean prizes. E equals MC squared. Practice makes perfect. Well, 1 Timothy says, false teaching equals friction. It's dangerous. Healthy teaching equals fruit. It's essential. And so if you're a Bible teacher, a small group leader, let's pray that we'll teach the truth. If you're a church member, let's pray that we listen with care. False teaching is dangerous. Healthy teaching is essential for a real church. And let's all remember that a healthy church keeps the gospel of Jesus Christ front and centre. And so, brothers and sisters, whatever you do with Junction 1 and however you proceed, let's keep the main thing, the main thing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you very much for the gospel of the Lord Jesus. Thank you for the letter of 1 Timothy. And we pray, Father, that you would help us to love healthy teaching, to listen to healthy teaching, and to be obedient to healthy teaching. Help us all to keep Jesus front and centre in our hearts, in our homes, and in our church, now and always. Amen.
Behold the man upon his cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom.
So thank you, Leddy, very much for sharing God's word with us and your advice and thoughts as well. And thank you for joining us tonight. Hope to see you in a minute on Zoom for prayer and encouragement.
So we're going to finish our time together with one of the Bible's great blessings. It's from Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 to 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen.
Amen. See you in a minute.